you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
All right, so today we're starting a new series. And the new series is I Am Jesus. I'm not Jesus, and you ought to be very thankful that I'm not Jesus. But Jesus is Jesus. In Exodus 3, verse 14, God said to Moses, I am who I am. Tell the people of Israel, I am sent you, sent me to you. God continued with Moses, and he said, this is what you're to say to the Israelites. God, the God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob sent me to you. This has always been my name, and this is how I will always be known. So I am is a covenant name of God, and Jesus reminded us of the importance of this name and who he is in the New Testament, because that's how he'll always be known. I am. So who is he to you? It's a good question. You might think, well, duh, he is my savior. Yeah. And that's great that we can say that. That's great that we believe that. But I believe that he wants to be more to us than we currently know, that we currently have relationship with him. He wants us to go beyond that level. See, to the dead man, he was life. To the searching, he was discovery. To the hurting, he was healing. To the questioner, he was the answer. To the sinner, he is the Savior. Shirley Bassey sang, I am. She always does that funny, what I am. And I had to watch her. I could hear my father, who used to really not like her. I would almost go into the word hate. But I don't want to say that my dad hated anybody. But he, every time she came on television, and she used to come on a lot when I was growing up as a kid, he'd say, I can't abide that woman. And I think it's because she did this. And she goes, I am. And she got the vibrato of her voice with a, and she went on to sing, and I won't try and get up there because I started a bit high, I am my own special creation. You ain't kidding, Shirley. I don't want to focus on Shirley Bassey right now, by the way, because that's not what the message is about. But many people believe that to be true about themselves, that they are their own special creation. I think the only word that I would use there is, yeah, you are special. Your own special creation. You have created your own special creation. But it's almost said in a dismissive way. Like, I am what I am. So take it or leave it. Like it or lump it. I am what I am. But we need to understand something about that. We need to understand something else. I am what I am because I'm a sinner, but I am who I am because of a Savior. I am who I am because of whose I am. And it's because he is that we are. We don't have to settle for what we are, if we are prepared to strive for who we can be. And by the way, Shirley, if you're watching, we are not our own special creation. We are his special creation. The Bible tells us that we are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, his own special people. We are children of the Most High God. We are the redeemed of the Lord, and we do say so. We are, Jesus said, the light of the world. Now, if that doesn't make you feel good today, there's something wrong with you. Because that ought to motivate you more than a seminar with Anthony Robbins. Let me tell you again, you are a chosen generation. You are a royal priesthood. You are a holy nation. You are his own special people. You are children of the Most High God. You are the redeemed of the Lord, and we do say so. And you are the light of the world. I know you feel uncomfortable with that, and I feel uncomfortable with that. I'm quite happy that Jesus is the light of the world, but he said, no, you are the light of the world. But in order to become who we truly are, we need to discover who he really is. In the book of John, Jesus makes 7 I am statements. Anybody worked out yet that this is therefore going to be a 7-week series? Now don't switch off. Now you're thinking, 7 weeks. It's all right. Different I am every week. I'm not going to do the same I am every week. Not unless you don't get it, and then I might have to repeat myself like Jesus had to constantly do. And with all these 7 I ams, he combined the I am with amazing metaphors which express the kind of relationship he wants with us. First one of those statements is found in John 6:35, where Jesus said, I am the bread of life. The person who aligns with me hungers no more and thirsts no more ever. I have told you this explicitly, because even though you have seen me in action, you don't really believe me. Every person the Father gives me eventually comes running to me. And once that person is with me, I hold on and don't let go. So you want another scripture about salvation being permanent? You know, we always use that nothing can separate us from the love of God. There's another one right there. He holds on, and he doesn't let go. I came down from heaven not to follow my own whim, but to accomplish the will of the one who sent me. Again, that ought to just motivate you and inspire you and make you feel good today. That's how much he cares. So I am one is I am the bread of life. You know, bread remains one of the UK's favorite foods, with a staggering 99% of households buying bread. I had to check that figure several times. 99% of us buy bread. Nearly 12 million loaves of bread are sold each day. And they say that's equivalent of 43 loaves per person per year and 99 bread products per household per year. I've got one thing to say, that's a lot of dough. We evidently eat 2 kilograms of bread each week. However, 32% of all the bread that we purchase, and we're just talking about the UK, 32% of the bread that we purchase gets thrown away, making it the most wasteful food that we buy. 60% of all flour products in the UK is found and used to make bread. Bread, would you believe it, costs 15% less in the UK than France. I'm not sure whether that's a useful bit of information, but I was just quite surprised that actually bread being the place that you, or France being the place you kind of associate with bread, and yet it's expensive. It's 15% more, probably more for us. Yeah. Now, oh, Brexit bread. We're in trouble now. Bread, I'm not getting into that argument. I'd split the church in 30 seconds if we start talking about Brexit. Bread is considered a staple food, a basic dietary item. A person can survive a long, long time on only bread and water. When the Israelites were wandering around that wilderness, going around that same old mountain for 40 years, it says that God rained down bread from heaven to sustain them. So bread is a sustainer. Bread is essential for life. And what Jesus was saying here was, look, I'm essential for life. I'm your spiritual bread. And just like you cannot do, if we only had bread as food, you cannot do without it. You know, you would die if you didn't eat it. They would have died had they not ate that bread from heaven. In the same way, you will not survive if you don't eat of this spiritual food. He is essential for life. This bread satisfies the inner longing and the deep hunger of the human heart. A doctor in America said some time ago that more people die of spiritual hunger than of physical starvation. Because, I believe, people all over the world are the same. We essentially are the same. We all have an inborn hunger for something. In fact, that something is actually someone. Because we all have a God-shaped hole that only Jesus can fill. We all have a God-shaped hole that only Jesus can fill. Nothing else can fit it. No one else can fill it. Let me say that again. We all have a God-shaped hole. Nothing else can fit it, and no one else will fill it. Because God has wired us in such a way that we will not be satisfied with anything less than Jesus. He's wired us that way. That's why people go searching. That's why we were searching for something. And people that search and search, they search and they think, I know, I'll get satisfied if I have more money, if I have a better car, if I have a bigger house, if I have more clothes, if I have more relationships, only to find that none of those things bring the lasting satisfaction because none of those things fill that God-shaped hole. The only thing that fills that God-shaped hole is Jesus. It's only Jesus. Do they still have those toys that we used to have with Gem, that like the ball with different shapes? It's still around. Isn't it amazing that technology has moved on, but that's still so powerful? And Gemma used to try and push those things through the hole, and you go, no, the round one goes in there. You can't put the round one in the square one, and you can't put the square one in the round one. And she'd try and try and try, and it's like, doesn't matter how much you try, it's not gonna fit. Because there's only one fit. It's Jesus. It's Jesus. In Ecclesiastes, this really blew me away. I knew this was here. I'd read it several times, but I guess in context with this message, it blew me away. Ecclesiastes 3 and verse 11 says that he has planted eternity in the human heart. You see what I'm trying to say? He's wired us. He's planted seed for eternity in the human heart. That's why nothing else will satisfy. That's why nothing else will do. Only Jesus. And to understand what that scripture really fully means, we have to read it in the Amplified Version, which really does say it best. He has also planted eternity, a sense of divine purpose in the human heart, a mysterious longing which nothing under the sun can satisfy except God. Jesus brings lasting satisfaction that outlasts us. It continues into and throughout eternity. He alone feeds our hunger and satisfies our longings. But isn't it interesting that in that scripture that we read, in verse 35, it goes on to say, the person who aligns with me hungers no more and thirsts no more ever. There's an important phrase there. The person who aligns with me hungers no more. Not the person that knows of me, not the person that knows me, but the person who aligns with me. When we come into spiritual alignment, that's when we have no longing and we have no hunger because we've aligned with God. Because part of that alignment is the realization that we all have a divine purpose because of a heavenly plan. And that makes all the world of difference. When we realize there's a purpose way beyond ourselves, a God purpose, we're not here for ourselves, we're here for God. When we realize that, and when we realize that we were not put here to become what we want to become, but to be who He needs us to be. Not for our plans, not for our schemes, and not for our desires, but for His purpose. And it's when we align ourselves with heavenly purpose, this is going to help somebody, that we stop searching for earthly significance. It's when we align ourselves with heavenly purpose that we stop searching for earthly significance. Isn't a lot of life just made up of us trying, firstly, to work out who we are? Instead of just accepting whose we are, yes. that actually gives us all the information about who we are. But we still do all this searching for who we are, who am I? And then we kind of do what Shirley Bassey says, and we create a special creation of ourselves, a particular model. And we don't then like that model. As that model gets a bit older, we're trying to search for ourselves again. In fact, as we get a bit older, we search for our youth. And we waste so much time trying to find out who we are because we're trying to really discover and carry on discovering our earthly significance. But actually, when we just settle back into our heavenly purpose, doesn't mean to say that we don't strive to do the best that we can. It doesn't mean to say that we don't strive to succeed in the things that God would have us do. But we just say, do you know what? I'm here for your purpose and your purpose alone. And that gives me earthly significance because there is no greater call than the calling of God. It's a high calling. It's a chosen calling. It's a great calling. He calls us the royal priesthood. Have we really got that? But you know, all of that comes through what we believe about who we are because of whose we are. It's appreciating what He's doing in our lives and not missing it because we're expecting Him to do something else. Purpose is not just found in what we do, but in who we are. How many people are trying to find their purpose in what they do, or they feel like they've found their purpose in what they do? But actually, it's not about what you do, it's about who you are. That's often the problem, isn't it? We only feel significance in what we do. It's amazing how some of the most confident people spiritually can be those that have got the worst jobs ever, but they know who they are in God. Yeah. It's not about what they do every day. It's about who they are and whose they are. See, going back to these guys that Jesus was trying to get through to, they were experiencing firsthand Jesus. I mean, I just want you to imagine that for a second. That Jesus is here, he's teaching us, and I mean, we are seeing firsthand, we're seeing miracles, we're seeing amazing things happen, we're hearing the best teaching that you could ever, ever hear. And yet, although they were experiencing it, they were missing it spectacularly. They saw it, but they didn't see it. Do you understand what I'm saying? Yeah. What they saw didn't change what they could see. Mm-hmm. It didn't change their beliefs. Mm-hmm. You see, because it's all about recognizing what God's done, is doing, and believing that he will do. Mm-hmm. I want to put it this way. Life is about marking every movement, every moment.
That's good. Yeah.
Marking every God movement, every moment. Appreciating the detail in everything that God does. Getting to a point of realization that we don't need to look elsewhere for anything. We have everything we need in Jesus. In our relationship with Jesus, we have everything that we're ever going to need. You will not find greater satisfaction than what you will find in your relationship with Jesus. I want to just help you not waste any more time searching for things that you're not, or you will find will not satisfy you. Just put all your effort, just put all your time, just put all your energy into your relationship with God, and you will be fulfilled. He will satisfy that spiritual hunger. He will satisfy and quench that thirst. Just like he said, every person the Father gives me eventually comes running to me. Eventually we get there. And instead of running from God, we run to him, which is what he's wanted us to do throughout our lives. But we keep running from him. Yeah. We run to him, and then we run from him. And then we run to him, and then we run from him. But we will eventually run to him and stay with him. Why? Because we get to a place where we realize God is everything we want because Jesus is everything we need. I am the bread of life, he says. See, it's interesting if you think about this story, and you might not have thought about this, so let me just tell you. The day before was a day that you've heard about. It's when he did his greatest miracle. He fed the 5,000. Well, actually, that was probably about 20,000. So let's say he fed the 20,000. To top all that, like he needed to, he then walked on water that night. I mean, it was just an average day in the life of Jesus. You know, those are the kind of things he does. He feeds the 20,000, and then when he just feels like it, he'll walk on water. He was trying to teach these guys something about himself because they were missing it so much. And yet they still didn't get what it was about. Listen to this. John 6:28. They replied, "We want to perform God's works too." In other words, we want to get in on the action, Jesus. The most important thing that we are focused on right now is about doing what you've just done, which is feeding 20,000 people and walking on water. How do we do it, Jesus? Teach me how to walk on water. Jesus told them, "This is the only work God wants you or from you. Believe in the one he has sent." They answered, I can't believe they said this. "Show us a miraculous sign if you want us to believe in you. What can you do?" I'm sure Jesus must have done that day after day. They said, show us a miracle. Yeah. Duh. He just did. Yeah. How much more do you want him to do? 20,000 people fed from a boy's lunchbox. Oh, what can you do, Jesus? He just walked on water. OMG. I mean, seriously, are you? I can feel like Jesus had a John McEnroe spirit on him that day. Are you serious? I mean, Jesus had so much grace. But before we start thinking less of them, let's be reminded of how we can be exactly the same. We can so easily do the very same thing, and we start making statements like, where's God in this? I can't see God. Even though he's done something miraculous, is doing something miraculous, and will continue to do great things in our life. But where's Jesus? They missed the point. We have the problem, the same problem as they had, by the way. It's never changed. It's like humanity. It's a problem. They miss the point. We miss the point. They miss the point, and this is the point we miss, that they wanted his power more than his presence. How many times do we miss his presence because we're more focused on his power? Oh, Jesus, if you could just cause that rabbit to come out the hat today, that would be really, really good. We're more focused on what we need him to do than who he wants to be. How often do we fail to sense his presence because we're looking for a sign of his power? So let me ask you a question. Are you more interested in what Jesus does or who Jesus is? Let me tell you something. There's not a wrong answer there, by the way. If you, well, there is, but I don't want you to feel bad. You know, the right answer is, you know, but I'm guessing that we're all going to say, do you know what? We're all guilty of actually wanting a relationship with Jesus because of what he can do. You know, because he is miraculous. He does do miraculous things in our lives. And the problem is we can water our relationship down to the acts of Jesus. You know, that we're waiting for the next act. Let me just say this. True satisfaction comes from who he is, not what he does. He will never be able to do enough. If we're looking for his power, if we're looking for his miracles, he will never be able to do enough to satisfy you. Because no sooner, I said this a few weeks ago, I think. I certainly said it recently. As soon as we've experienced one miracle, we're on to the next one. We got such a short memory. We got spiritual dementia. We do. Because, like, God can do an amazing miracle one day, and then the next day we're going, God, where are you? Just like the disciples, they had spiritual dementia. And we're on to the next thing. And if we're not careful, we just got the list. God, I need you to do that. That's good. I can tick that one, but I still need you to do that one. It's getting a bit close now. We're on the 11th hour, and you haven't moved in this situation. And the more we get to the 11th hour, we're like, oh, God, where are you? You know, God will never, ever stop challenging us about this stuff. Why? Because he wants us to get it. Because unless we get it, we won't be satisfied. And he wants us satisfied. He doesn't want us hungering because he knows that we will go and try and find something to fill that hole only to find that we've ruined a bit more of our lives. I want to make this personal. I'm not pointing my finger at you. That's what I do. My finger goes all over the place. Just can't control it. But I'm not pointing at you personally. I'm just saying, it's personal. What are you looking for that you feel like you haven't found in God? So instead of looking to God and saying, I need you to speak to me and tell me what I'm missing here, you look elsewhere, thinking that the answer is elsewhere. I believe there's some people watching today and they've looked everywhere. And actually, some have discovered us today. Maybe they would say by accident. I'd say on purpose. On God's purpose. Because he doesn't want you to look any longer because he is everything you need. And maybe you can identify with this, that actually you're searching and searching, and it's like, well, what are you trying to find? Because everything you need is already here. I love the fact that Jesus ends this whole thing. I'm almost done. He says, once that person is with me, I hold on and don't let go. That's the greatest end to a story. How amazing is that? That once we're with him, he's with us. He will never leave us. He will never let us go. When we let go, he hangs on. When we leave, he stays. When we quit, he continues. When we wander, he remains. How amazing is that? I mean, what God would do that? I mean, what person would do that? They're stupid. But God said, you know what? I love you that much and I won't let you go. Doesn't matter how much you move away from me, I will never move away from you. He wants to be the bread of life so that we will never hunger or thirst ever again. I wonder whether we could get to a place today where we could pray and we could stand in his presence and say, God, okay, I'm going to stop looking everywhere else for satisfaction. I'm going to stand in your presence and I'm going to believe that you are here, because that's what you said you would do when two or three come together, that you are there. So I'm going to believe that you are here. And I'm going to say face to face, you are everything I need. Let's stand. Do you know, after 3 years, Jesus still had to ask this question. He said, so who do you say I am? 3 years. 3 years they've been on the road, on tour with Jesus. And he says, so who do you say I am? What was he doing? He was saying, listen, just because you've been with me, just because I've been with you, just because you've seen great things, just because we've had some great, you know, experiences together, doesn't mean to say that you really know who I am. Maybe you've been searching for lasting satisfaction. You haven't found what you're looking for. Maybe you're tuned in on Periscope or Facebook and you're searching. You're looking for satisfaction. You're looking for fulfillment. And you've tried here and you've tried there and you've tried everywhere. But maybe you've never tried God. You've never tried Jesus. You see, the reason that you still have a hole in your heart is because only Jesus can fill it. and we can try everything else, but nothing else fits. Because the essential is missing. He's essential for your life. He's essential for everybody's life. And Jesus is saying, look, you know, people will get there eventually. They'll realize that they'll go through all the years of their life and they won't still find what they're looking for because they're looking in the wrong place. But when they run to me and realize that I am the bread, I am the essential. So I want to do two things. I want to pray for those who today want to fill that hole with Jesus. And I'm believing that there might be people in the house and certainly people online, and they've never filled that hole with Jesus. They've tried filling it with 1,001 other things and nothing's fit. But today, I want to just give you the opportunity to put Jesus in that hole. Let's pray. If you want Jesus to fit in that hole, I want to encourage you to pray this prayer with me and just say, God, today, you know I've been searching and searching and searching, and I still haven't found what I'm looking for. But today, I believe that I was in the right place at the right time, hearing the right message. And so I want to fit you into that hole so that you will fill that void that makes me so hungry, gives me a longing that I can't even imagine, and a thirst that I've really struggled to quench. But I know now from what I've heard this morning that you are the essential for my life. So I'm going to put you there. I'm going to try Jesus. I want to say sorry for all the things I've done when I've tried to fit other things in that hole. And I thank you for your grace, and I thank you for your love, and I thank you for the good news of this message that says, once I've found you, you will never let me go. So I found you. Thank you, Jesus. I found you today. Thank you. This is the greatest day in my life. I found the essential. I found Jesus. And because I found Jesus, I'm going to find myself. Because it's in you that I find my identity. It's in you that I find purpose. It's in you that I will experience satisfaction. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Can I ask, as we keep our eyes closed, did anybody pray that in the house today, to raise your hand? Praise God. If you prayed that prayer online, would you let us know? We want to help you. We want to get connected with you to help you get connected with the church so that you will have people around you that can help you on this journey that you've started. And we would be privileged to help you to do that. So just somehow contact us. There's lots of ways you can do that. Just find a way and we will do whatever we can to help you. I want to speak, and I want to speak on camera as well, but I want to speak to you. Maybe you're already in a relationship with Jesus. But you know what? 3 years on, 10 years on, 30 years on, I won't go any higher. Jesus is still asking you, so who do you say that I am? Not the person next to you, but who do you say, who am I to you? And if you're honest, as I've had to be honest, because the same question applies to me. Mike, who do you say? Who am I to you? If you're honest like me, You've been so focused on his power that you've missed his presence. I wonder if anybody else can admit that today. You know, just raise your hand if that's you. You've been so focused on his power that you've missed his presence. And his presence was what he wanted you to experience. And that presence is so personal. It's just you and him, like we sang earlier, just me and you. Do you know that far exceeds anything that he could ever, ever do? I mean, he could walk on water every day and you just get fed up of it. But his presence has another thing. The way his presence works never, ever causes us to tire. I want to pray for those that put their hands up. If you want to be included in that, I'll pray for you too. That today would be the day of change. If you're watching online, that this would be the day that you say, do you know what? I'm not going to keep looking anywhere else. Because things come and things go. And do you know, the very thing that I thought would bring me satisfaction didn't bring me satisfaction. Because only Jesus will fit and fill that hole. And I get it, Jesus. I get it. Finally, the penny's dropped. Yeah. If that's you, I'm going to pray for you. Father, thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for being so clear in this message about the things that you want us to hear, but also the things that we've missed so spectacularly. And we would normally talk about the disciples like they're a little bit dumb, but actually we have to admit that today we are shoulder to shoulder with them in the things that we've missed. We've been so focused on one thing that we've missed the main thing. And so, Father, we thank you that you've given us another opportunity right now to come before you in your presence here, and your presence is very evident today. We know your Holy Spirit is working in this place, in our hearts right now, doing surgery in this place right now. We can sense there's something different today about this place. There's a different atmosphere in this place today. We can sense your anointing and presence in this place. We thank you for this opportunity right now to come before you and say, Jesus, I'm not going to look anywhere else but to you for my satisfaction, because you will feed my hunger and you will quench my thirst. Thank you, Jesus. Come on, let that attitude of gratitude start to rise up on the inside of you and start to give him praise for all that he's done in this last 35, 40 minutes. Thank you, Lord, that you've done something amazing through this word. Come on, give him great praise today. Give him praise. Give him praise from your lips. Give him praise from your hands. Give him praise from your feet. In Jesus' name, amen.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.